a massive teddy bear behind me. I didn't place him right. Hello, my name is Bobo, and this is a video I've been wanting to do for a really long time, and it's all about this condition that I have. I have a condition called hereditary spasticity paraplegia. It's a very rare condition, and it only affects about 3 in every 100,000 people. Because it's a hereditary condition though, the 3 in the 100,000 are usually relatives. There are two types of hereditary spasticity paraplegia. There is the pure form and then there is the complex form. About 90% of people with this condition have the pure form, which can give you a range of symptoms from stiffness in the leg, involuntary spasms, muscle stiffness, and lots of lower limb weakness. The remaining 10% who have the complex form also have the same symptoms as the pure form, but they also have a different range of symptoms such as blindness, deafness, upper body muscle spasms and memory loss, weakness, shooting pains from all over the body, not just the lower limbs. Some people with this condition will eventually start using a walking cane, a wheelchair, any kind of walking aids like crutches to help them get around, as the stiffness can progress into something much worse. Other symptoms with the complex form can include nerve damage in the feet, epilepsy, problems with balance, coordination and speech, dementia, hearing loss, problems swallowing and breathing, and problems with the eyesight and hearing. As well as all of the physical symptoms, some of the other symptoms can include depression and anxiety due to the extreme pain. The symptoms for this condition usually show up in early childhood, with children tripping over or having lack of balance. They can complain of like pains in their feet. The first signs that I personally showed was I had weak ankles and they would kind of collapse all the time. And usually they waddle a little bit, or lots of different things like that. It's more of a warning sign if somebody in your family has it. There's a 50% chance of it being passed down to the children if you have it yourself. Many people with this condition will go on a medicine called baclofen. This is a muscle relaxant and can help ease some of the pain that the people get. Most people who have this condition will also go through physiotherapy or hydrotherapy or some form of occupational therapy to help them get through the condition. Some people even have surgery to release the tendons to make it easier to move. So I have this condition, and it's really rare and really exciting, really interesting, but it's obviously quite difficult. I got passed down this condition from my dad, who got it from his mum. His brother also has the condition as well. Growing up, it was quite a struggle. I was always a little bit different from the other children. I could never really run. I never really took part in the sports or the PE games. I was very close friends with someone who had cerebral palsy, and we would always go back to the classroom early because we took so long to change, and we'd have to sit out of lots of activities. I could never really sit down in assemblies, and I could never sit cross-legged in assemblies and listen. So I had to sit in proper chairs, but because I was so young and because it was so small back then, I was never ever diagnosed with anything. I went to doctors a lot through my childhood and they all said it was just growing pains, because it was something that is so rare that they'd never even heard of before. So what do you expect, I suppose? I had it severe symptoms right up until I was about 13, and I got in contact with my dad again. So he took me to his specialist, who diagnosed me when I was 16 with hereditary spasticity paraparesis. Now, it was a very strange thing to be diagnosed with it, because one, it was something I'd never heard of before. Two, it was something I had no one to relate to with, and it was something I had to find out all on my own. I had my dad to help me, but it was not really the same, because my dad has type 1 and I have type 2. See, he would only have the symptoms in his legs and in his spine, and whereas I would get shooting pains up my arms and in my face, and I'd have my wrists collapse and be in agony because I couldn't write in school. And it was all so much more, it was very confusing, and like I had to cope with having the weight of breasts or bigger hips, so they move differently, and the symptoms varied when I was on my period. So that it was very strange being a female with this condition, and my only role model with it being my father, who was male. Sorry if I've moved, I had a guest Yeah, so when I was diagnosed with my condition, I was also diagnosed with something called internal femoral torsion, which basically means that my hips turned in way too much, which meant that my knees turned in and my feet turned in, which meant that I also sat in the W sitting position. So my bum is in the middle here, these two bits of my knees, and these two bits of my feet. And it was so comfortable. Usually people who sit like this, it's not really an issue with children who sit like this. You usually either outgrow it or it's just something that doesn't affect them. Because of my other condition, the two added together made things awful for me. It was so painful going upstairs, or it was painful to walk up a hill because I was putting way too much pressure on my knees. Because as I walked, instead of my knees going like that, well, the pressure going through my entire leg and into my feet, the pressure was going into my knees because my legs bent wrong, basically. So when I was 17, I was booked in for a bilateral femoral rotational surgery, which basically means they chopped my hip bones in half, rotated the bottom half so that my knees and feet turned outwards and forward, and then plated them back together so that my hips were comfortable and my feet were forward. And I was so excited, and I'd never had surgery before, and it was gonna be like life-changing. Hopefully, there was a chance it could have been pointless other than to look nice, but I was so excited. I had the surgery on October 16th in 2016. So after my surgery, I was in hospital for 8 days, and over those 8 days I had to learn to walk again, and it was hard. The first night was a real blur. I had been drugged up a lot on morphine and painkillers. I had an epidural in my back to numb my entire bottom half, which meant that I also had to have a catheter which took the urine out of my body so I didn't wet myself. And it was all a bit nuts, really. I could not move because I had it done on both of my hips. Lots of people have them only done on one at a time or just one. I could not turn on my side to sleep. I had to sleep on my back, straight on this, and I had to sleep on this. I was on a ward for knee and hip replacements, which are not as painful as they seem. They are much less painful than what I had done. So they weren't really equipped for it, because again, it's a very rare thing to have done. I had a specialist surgeon do it, so it was very, yeah. Over the next few days though, I had to do lots of physiotherapy. I had to learn how to stand and support myself again. I had to learn how to lift my legs up, even though the pain in my hips was strong. I had to learn to walk with crutches. I had to learn to walk with a frame and then with crutches. So while I was in hospital, I should have left a lot earlier than I did. Lots of the people on my ward were leaving much earlier than I was because I had an issue with fainting. I kept fainting every time I stood up. So I had to have more drugs in me, and I had to have things. Eventually, my mum started bringing me big liter bottles of water, which I had to finish every day, and that helped a lot. And then eventually I started to get better, and they won't let you leave the hospital until you've mastered the stairs. That was the big thing. You could walk as far as you wanted to, but you had to master the stairs. And I mastered the stairs, finally. But I did get to, I had a shower before I went to do the stairs, and it was very hot. So when I got to the top of the stairwell, I fainted. Yeah, but they still let me go home. And I was on bed rest for quite a while. I went back to college for a day or two just to say, I am fine, I'm still alive. But then took about 2 months off before I was finally strong enough to go back to college. When I was in college, I had to use a wheelchair to get around during the day, but use my crutches on the way home and to college. It was a bit tough, really. I was lucky I had a supportive family and supportive friends. I would get picked up and dropped places a lot. My family would help me with anything I needed to. Getting in and out of the bath was a struggle. I had to go to my dad's house quite a bit because he has a walk-in shower, and I used to sit in stalls, and it was all a bit of a tiring journey. But about a year later, I was finally fully able to be completely off my crutches, and it took a lot longer than I thought it would, but it was done, and I had metal in my legs, and I was walking much better than I was beforehand. I was still struggling, and it was still quite sore and tiring, but my actual physical walking had improved. When I first started to learn to walk again, I waddled like a chicken. Because most people with this condition do waddle anyway, because it's much easier to pull your hips off the ground like this than lifting them up forward like that on their own, if that makes sense. So I'll insert some clips now about, these are some progression clips that I took when I was learning to walk again, so I'll put them in the order and the dates here. So I waddled like a chicken for a long time, and I'm much better now, thank God. And I still struggle, but not because of the operation. I struggle with the condition, because it's still, like, as much as I'm healed from the operation, that's all fine and done. This condition I'll have forever. It affects everything. Like, currently I have my arm wrapped up in a bandage because my wrist collapsed last night. So it's day-to-day struggle, really, but I feel like there needs to be more information about this condition, and I feel like not many people know about it, not many people know how to treat it, because lots of people with it look perfectly normal, but both me and my dad look perfectly normal on our good days, and even on our bad days I can still be limping, but I look normal. So I feel like there needs to be more awareness about invisible illnesses like this. Don't know what else to say. Yeah, so that's been my video about hereditary spasticity paraparesis. I hope that I can clear up a bit of the stigma around things like this. I plan to be making loads more videos in the future about topics and things I want to talk about. So if you want to stick around and watch them, sure, do it. Yeah, so that's been my video. Hope you enjoyed it. I hope you learned something. Share it if you know anybody with this condition. If you or anybody with this condition is watching, leave a comment, subscribe, like, do those things. Bye.